السلام علیکم ورحمۃ اللہ. اشهد ان لا اله الا الله وحده لا شريك له واشهد ان محمدا عبده ورسوله. اما بعد فاعوذ بالله من الشيطان الرجيم. بسم الله الرحمن الرحيم. الحمد لله رب العالمين الرحمن الرحيم مالك يوم الدين إياك نعبد وإياك نستعين اهدنا الصراط المستقيم صراط الذين أنعمت عليهم غير المغضوب عليهم ولا الضالين. دو دن پہلے
Two days ago, a long-standing servant of the Ahmadiyya community, respected Sahibzada Mirza Khursheed Ahmad Sahib, passed away. Inna lillahi wa inna ilayhi raji'un. Surely to Allah we belong, and to Him shall we return. Allah the Almighty bestowed the honor upon him of having a spiritual connection with the promised Messiah, alayhi salatu wassalam, as well as being part of his family. This is the law of Allah the Almighty, that one who comes to this world has to depart it one day, and everything is mortal, and the only eternal being is Allah the Almighty. However, fortunate are those who try to make this present life bestowed by Allah the Almighty purposeful and try to attain the pleasure of Allah the Almighty. They understand that their mere kinship with any righteous person or wali, i.e. friend of God or a saint or prophet, cannot make their lives purposeful, and nor will this entitle them to attain the pleasure of Allah the Almighty. Rather, it is a person's own action and conduct which allows him to attain the pleasure of Allah the Almighty. The promised Messiah, alayhi salatu wassalam, mentioned at an occasion that the Holy Prophet, peace be upon him, used to tell Hazrat Fatima, may Allah be pleased with her, that, O Fatima, you cannot attain the pleasure of Allah the Almighty merely by being my daughter. In order to attain his pleasure, you must try to fashion your life in accordance with his commandments. And once you have done so, you should still instill the fear of Allah the Almighty, praying that Allah the Almighty may accept your endeavors and make your end a good end through His grace. I had a close relationship with Mirza Khursheed Ahmad Sahib and also had the opportunity to observe him from close, and I am personally aware of this fact, and many people have also written to me as well, and I have received numerous letters stating that he strived to fulfill his waqf, i.e. his devotion of life, and also to accomplish his duties with great humility. He never exhibited any ancestral pride. Last year, as he was here for the Jalsa, i.e. the annual convention, he expressed his concern to me about his good end. And while doing so, he gave the example of a very righteous man who, when he was about to die, kept repeating, "Not yet, not yet." Eventually, he died in that very state. And so, his disciples prayed very earnestly to find out what the reason had been for his saying, "Not yet, not yet." Once, a disciple saw the same holy man in his dream, and so he asked him as to why he kept repeating, "Not yet, not yet," at the time of his demise. Upon this, the holy man answered that the matter is as follows, that when the time of my death came, Satan approached me and said to me that you have managed to escape me and you have accomplished such righteous deeds. However, I kept repeating that not yet, not yet. So long as I am breathing, who knows what action I may commit? Therefore, even at the time of death, I was saying not yet to Satan, and Allah the Almighty took my life in that state, and now I am in paradise. Thus, this is how those who are concerned for their end worry. Such is the way of those who worry for their end. In any case, this is an example which he narrated to me, and he was very concerned. He understood the spirit of waqf, i.e. devotion, and he was a senior figure who worked while keeping this in view. According to our local time, he passed away the day before yesterday at approximately 10 p.m. He was 85 years old, and he was the paternal great-grandson of the promised Messiah, alayhi salatu wassalam. He was the grandson of Hazrat Mirza Sultan Ahmad Sahib, the eldest son of the promised Messiah, alayhi salam, and he was the son of Hazrat Mirza Aziz Ahmad Sahib, radiyallahu ta'ala anhu. Hazrat Mirza Aziz Ahmad Sahib was the paternal grandson of the promised Messiah, alayhi salam, who did the bayt, i.e. took the oath of allegiance, before his father. He was born on 12th September 1932 in Lahore, and on the 21st April 1945, at the age of 12 and a half, he filled out the waqf form in order to dedicate his life for the service of Jamaat, and at the time he was studying in the 9th grade. He completed his matriculation in the High School of Qadian, and he then received his education from the TI College, following which, in accordance with the instructions of Hazrat Musleh Maud, may Allah be pleased with him, he acquired an MA degree in English from the Government College in Lahore. On 10th September 1956, he joined the TI College in Rabwa as a life devotee and rendered his services there in the field of teaching English for 17 years. He prepared his lectures with great diligence, and I have also been taught by him, and many students have written to me that he would come well prepared and would teach with great diligence. He had full command over his subject, and this is the reason why he was popular among the students and why they liked him very much. In 1964, he came to England for 1 year on a scholarship of the British Council for a course in English phonetics, and here he acquired his education in the University of Leeds. I will now present some of his services to the Jamaat. In the days of unrest in 1974, respected Sahibzada Mirza Khursheed Ahmad Sahib helped and assisted Hazrat Khalifatul Masih III. He stayed in the residence of the Khalifa in order to render his assistance towards him, and he stayed in the residence of the Khalifa, i.e. Qasr-e Khilafat, for a period of 2 or 3 months continuously. Similarly, with the approval of Hazrat Musleh Maud, may Allah be pleased with him, in the middle of 1962, an institute called An-Nusrat was established for the care and education and upbringing of orphaned and poor children. Later, Hazrat Khalifatul Masih III changed its name to Imdadul Tulaba, i.e. help and support for students. And he was in charge of this department from 1978 until July 1983. Following that, this task was entrusted to the Department of Education. On 30th April 1973, he was appointed as the Nazir Khidmat-e-Dirveshan, i.e. Director of Service towards the Dervish. And from 1st May 1976 until 1988, he rendered his services as the additional Nazir-e-Ala, i.e. additional Executive Director of Sadr Anjuman Ahmadiyya. He was also enabled to serve as a member of various committees. And from October 1988 until September 1991, he rendered his services as the Nazir-e-Amur-e-Amma, i.e. Director of General Affairs. He also served as the Nazir Amur-e Kharja, i.e. Director of External Affairs, from August 1992 until May 2003. Following this, during my Khilafat, I appointed him as the Nazir-e-Ala, i.e. Executive Director of Sadr Anjuman Ahmadiyya, as well as the Amir Muqami, i.e. the local Amir of Rabwa. He rendered this service in a most handsome manner. He also served as a member of Majlis-e-Iftar and Qaza Board, i.e. the judicial boards, for approximately 12 or 13 years. And in 1973, Allah the Almighty enabled him to perform the obligation of Hajj. On 26 September 1955, Hazrat Khalifatul Masih II led his nikah, i.e. marriage announcement. And at the time, there were five or six other marriage announcements which were settled that day. With regards to Mirza Khursheed Ahmad Sahib, Hazrat Khalifatul Masih II stated in his sermon, Hazur stated that this boy is also a life devotee from among our family. Mirza Aziz Ahmad Sahib was enabled to grant this child of his a very good education. Hence, this son of his is currently completing his MA studies, though he has not passed yet, or he had not completed his MA, but is sitting his exams in MA English. And it is said that he is very competent in English. Thus, it is my desire for him to serve as a professor in a college following this. Hazur also stated that he will be an asset in the field of translation with others as well. Allah the Almighty blessed him with six sons. Four of his sons are life devotees, two of them are doctors. One has a PhD and is serving as the Deputy Director in Nazarat-e-Taleem, i.e. the Department of Education. And similarly, one of them has studied law and is serving as an assistant in the office of the legal advisor. He was enabled to serve in various capacities in the auxiliary organizations. He also served as the Sadr Ansarullah, i.e. the auxiliary organization for the elders of the community from 2000 until 2003. One of his sons, Dr. Mirza Sultan Ahmed Sahib, writes that he had great love for Hazrat Khalifatul Masih II. A few years ago, he started to suffer from heart disease. As a matter of fact, he suffered from this for several years, but it slowly and gradually increased. And it was when he had traveled to Akara that he came to know about this. And so, one of his sons went to bring him back, and Dr. Nuri was also with them. And they were traveling there when they met him on the way as he was returning. And upon seeing them, Mirza Khursheed Ahmad Sahib stated that I was praying the entire journey that I would reach Rabwa. I was praying that I could reach Rabwa so that I could pass away at the feet of Hazrat Khalifatul Masih II. In other words, the place where he is buried and the area which he populated. Thus, such was the story of his love and affection towards Hazrat Khalifatul Masih II. He further writes, i.e. his son, that when he fell ill, he woke up one night and sat up in great distress and said that I just saw a lengthy dream that some people are criticizing Hazrat Khalifatul Masih II. However, no one is replying to them. And due to the fact that people were not replying, he became very restless and did not go back to sleep as a result. He frequently used to say that the opponents are very spiteful towards Hazrat Khalifatul Masih II. As a matter of fact, even more so than towards the promised Messiah, alayhi salatu wassalam. And the reason for this is that the opponents believe, which is correct to some extent, as a matter of fact, it is correct to a great extent, that Hazrat Khalifatul Masih II established and strengthened the system of the Jamaat. If he had not established the system of the Jamaat, i.e. the Nizam-e-Jamaat, this Jamaat would have been eradicated in the eyes of the opponents. However, this is the Jamaat of Allah the Almighty, which was destined to flourish, and all of this was bound to take place. However, many people opposed Hazrat Khalifatul Masih II as he endowed the Jamaat with a strong and firm system, i.e. Nizam. As I mentioned, in 1974, he served in the team which was formed by Hazrat Khalifatul Masih III. And he had the opportunity to serve there and stay in Qasr-e-Khilafat, i.e. the residence of the Khalifa. Following this, after perhaps a period of a month or a month and a half, it was then that he received permission to visit his family, and even then for only once in the week. In other words, he would visit his family for an hour or two after 7 days, and his children would also come there in order to visit him. He says that in those days, I observed that Hazrat Khalifatul Masih III did not sleep for several nights. Rather, he would rest while sitting and spend the entire day and the entire night either occupied in the service of the Jamaat or occupied in prayers. Subsequently, those people who were performing duties alongside him would also remain awake. His son narrates another account with regards to him that he was also a part of the team which was formed by Hazrat Khalifatul Masih IV in the extremely troublesome period of 1984. He says that he used to say that whenever circumstances of unrest arose, Hazrat Khalifatul Masih III, as well as Hazrat Khalifatul Masih IV, would remain extraordinarily relaxed instead of panicking in any manner. He also received the honor of being a part of the entourage from Rabwa to Karachi at the time of the migration of Hazrat Khalifatul Masih IV. Similarly, despite his illness, when the incident occurred on 28th May 2010 in Lahore, he first and foremost controlled and managed the entire situation in these circumstances of unrest with great courage. Secondly, despite the heat, he would personally lead the funeral prayer of every martyr who was brought to Rabwa, and he would also go for its burial. Similarly, he was very mindful of respecting everyone according to their status. His son Mirza Adil Ahmad writes that when we would send the reports of the local regions of Rabwa, we had at times neglectfully only written the Arabic letter Sa'd after the name of the Holy Prophet, peace be upon him, whereas we had fully written Alayhi Salam, i.e. may peace be upon him, after the name of the promised Messiah, Alayhi Salatu Wassalam. Upon this, he particularly drew our attention towards being mindful of respecting everyone according to their status, and that we should fully write may peace and blessings be upon him after the name of the Holy Prophet, sallallahu alayhi wasallam. He was also very regular in prayers, and he would only combine prayers in utmost compelling circumstances, Even during the days of his last illness, when he was admitted into hospital, he offered every prayer, apart from a few, at their appointed time and separately. He was serving as Nazir Allah during the time before his demise, and there is a tremendous responsibility that comes with this office, as there are various Jamaat-related affairs and cases that need to be overseen. When he was admitted to hospital, he would inquire about updates and the court dates of different cases repeatedly. Also, upon receiving wedding invitations from people, he would attend such events as Nazir Allah and Amir Mukami. He would say that since I am representing Khalifatul Masih, now this is an obligation for me. Similarly, visiting people at times of funerals and other tragic occasions, meeting the sick and the needy, and to inquire about their well-being, and also coming to the office and working throughout the office hours despite his illness, were all his virtues. During his last days, when he was very ill, he came to the office and observed that many people were not present. So he dispatched a circular stating that if this humble one can come to the office, then why cannot everyone else? From an administrative perspective, he would be strict when needed, and at the same time, he would explain things to others in a compassionate manner. When Hazrat Khalifatul Masih III passed away in Islamabad, Pakistan, he had the honour of leading the funeral prayers while in Islamabad, since he was the representative of Anjuman Ahmadiyya. Hazrat Khalifatul Masih IV was also present, but Hazur asked Mirza Khursheed Ahmad Sahib to lead the funeral prayers, even though Mirza Khursheed Ahmad Sahib asked Hazur to lead it, as he was older. But Hazrat Khalifatul Masih Rabi asked him to lead, since he was the representative of Anjuman. Similarly, he also received the honour of washing the body of Hazrat Khalifatul Masih III at the time of his demise. Mirza Ghulam Ahmad Sahib writes that during the circumstances of 1974, Mirza Khursheed Ahmad Sahib stayed with Hazrat Khalifatul Masih III. And when the situation improved, Hazur advised him to go home. However, Hazur would assign him some work and instructed that he should give him a daily report during breakfast. And Mirza Khursheed Ahmad Sahib would take instructions from Hazur and every day would return the next day with a daily report on the implementation of those instructions. Similarly, Mirza Ghulam Ahmad Sahib writes, after the demise of Hazrat Khalifatul Masih III, and the election of Hazrat Khalifatul Masih IV. The next day, the ring of the promised Messiah alayhi salam, which states, "Alaysa Allahu bikafin abdahu," i.e. that is Allah not sufficient for his servant, was misplaced. Hazrat Khalifatul Masih IV was extremely concerned about this, and so Hazur called Mirza Khursheed Ahmad Sahib and stated that he is faithful to me and to Khilafat, and so he informed him about the misplaced ring and told him to search for it. By the grace of Allah the Almighty, that ring was later recovered. Last year, his wife passed away, and he also got very ill afterwards, and was suffering from a heart condition. I called him here to attend the Jalsa, by the annual convention. However, first he was very concerned that perhaps he will not be able to travel, but still in any case he came. And while here, his condition improved significantly and he became very active. He would come and meet me every night despite the weather. He was never concerned about the weather and met me every night while he was here. Fauzia Shmeem Saiba, Sadr Lajna Lahore, and daughter of Hazrat Nawab Amtul Hafiz Begum Saiba, who was the youngest daughter of the promised Messiah, alayhi salatu wasalam, writes, his virtues became more prominent after becoming Nazri Allah. He was a very humble servant of the Jamaat. I would call him many times regarding official matters. If he was in a meeting, he would call me back later on. Many a times it so happened that I received an urgent request to receive an amount from Maryam Shadi Fund on a very short notice. I would call him and apologize for the short notice and share the situation with him. However, he would very calmly instruct me to collect the funds from Amir Sahib, or he would advise me to take care of it, and he would send funds later. He was very compassionate. She further states, I have never seen someone as kind-hearted as him. There was a young girl from a village that was going through a really difficult time. The girl was getting out of control and would not listen to anyone. I submitted this case to Mirza Khursheed Ahmad Sahib, and he handled the situation with immense sympathy and affection. He informed me about his visit to Qadian during that time. This was not during Jalsa Qadian, rather it was another visit to Qadian that he had planned. He said to me, I prayed specially for this girl in Baitul Dua. She says, by the grace of Allah the Almighty, the girl returned to the right path and got married as well. And he sent her a very beautiful jewelry set as a wedding gift, and also continued to inquire about her well-being later on. He was a very affectionate person. She further states, whenever I sought his consultation, he gave me an excellent advice. He was a very spiritual person and a well-wisher for all. Where can we find such a noble man now? My heart is in so much pain right now. May Allah the Almighty grant Khilafat with a better replacement, and may Allah the Almighty grant the family of the promised Messiah alayhi salam a person to replace him. While speaking about him, Chaudhry Hamidullah Sahib, Wakil-e-Ala Tehreek-e-Jadid, writes, when the Taleemul Islam College was transferred, many non-Ahmadi teachers who taught English stayed in Lahore and did not move to Rabwah. Respected Mia Khursheed Ahmad Sahib was the one who recognized the English department in 1956. His English was very good, and I remember that during his time, the standard of English improved significantly. Chaudhry Hamidullah Sahib further writes, he was very kind-hearted, forgiving and forbearing. He would provide for the poor, both on a personal and administrative capacity. He further states, throughout the time in college, he assisted me with all matters pertaining to Khudamul Ahmadiyya and Majlis Ansarullah, Jalsa arrangements as well. He would always participate in people's sorrow and joy. Whether it was a wedding or a funeral, he would always be there. Once, a senior volunteer of Jalsa Salana passed away, and Mia Sahib was not informed about this, and he regretted this a lot. One of the workers of Nazarat Ulya states, Fuzail Sahib, that he had many qualities and it is not possible to mention them. He was a very affectionate, loving, sociable and helpful person, and he had immense sympathy towards those who were afflicted with difficulties. He was a very simple person but possessed a very dignified personality. He was very much adored. I had the good fortune of serving under him for 10 years approximately. He further states that I do not remember that he ever expressed anger or displeasure at anything. If a mistake occurred, he would guide with immense love, tenderness and compassion. Another missionary who works in the office of Nazarat-e-Ulia, Khwaja Muzaffar Sahib, states, he faced a long, demanding illness with immense courage and dignity. I had the opportunity to serve alongside him for a very long time. He was more kind than a very affectionate father, and he was kind-hearted and possessed a high rank in providing service to mankind. Many a times it so happened that when someone in need sought for help, he would grant approval for their food and bedding and provided financial assistance as well. However, sometimes after the person in need would leave, he would hold me back and would instruct me to visit their home and find out more about them and report back. The Murabbi Sahib further states that the next day when I would present the report to him, he would say, my heart said that this person was more needy, and he was not assisted accordingly. And so, not only did he provide help to those who asked for it, rather he also investigated in order to provide help in accordance with their needs. He further writes, he had a very benevolent and forbearing disposition. He always had a smile on his face, and he always overlooked and forgave others. If someone filed a complaint, or if instructions were not followed according to his desire, he would advise lovingly. He would patiently listen to others for a long time, and this attribute is a responsibility of every office holder. If office holders patiently listen to what people have to say, then a lot of issues, in fact, many grievances can be eradicated. Murabbi Sahib writes, on one occasion, someone presented his request in a disrespectful manner and demonstrated lack of patience by tearing up the application into many pieces. Mirza Khursheed Ahmad Sahib remained silent. Perhaps he was praying for this person. He further states, I was standing nearby and disliked this person's disrespectful attitude. I was about to do something, however, Mirza Khursheed Ahmad Sahib said, do not worry about it and let it go. Do not say anything to this person. He said, everyone has their own mode of conduct. Thus, after witnessing his patience and forbearance, I would envy the fact that despite being so weak, i.e. due to his illness, he possessed such strengths in his faculties. Furthermore, his memory was also very praiseworthy and excellent, and he also pondered very carefully over matters. He further states, he would check thousands of letters and reports on a daily basis. However, it happened on numerous occasions that a matter had been submitted months in advance, but when the person who submitted a case would seek an update or request for prayers about a pending matter, the workers would start searching for it on their computers. But Mirza Khursheed Ahmad Sahib would remember the update or would be aware of the relevant instructions pertaining to a specific case, and also the total number of pages in that relevant file. Thus, he was fully aware of all the files in his office and had complete knowledge of all the office matters. Rashid Javed Sahib, Nazim Qazar states, there was a matter between a husband and a wife in which the husband wanted reconciliation in all circumstances. However, everything was settled, but the wife demanded that her husband should return the money that he had taken from her. However, the husband's financial status was very weak. Nazim Qazar Sahib states that I met Mia Sahib and requested him verbally to contribute something for this man's aid, and that I will also arrange for something in this regard. Then I said to him that you are our elder, please can you pay the entire amount? Mia Sahib laughed upon hearing this and said, if this will help with the reconciliation, then submit this request in writing. Therefore he made this payment and this couple's reconciliation was arranged within a few minutes. Rabbani Sahib, a missionary from Fazl Umar Foundation states, on one occasion, my sisters visited Rabwa. They suffered from a skin ailment and requested accommodation in the newly constructed Darul Ziyafat in order to get cleaner rooms. However, due to some administrative regulations, my sisters were informed that permission from Nazir Allah Sahib is needed for exceptional situations. My sisters said, we were very afraid that how can we even get an appointment to meet such a busy and such a high-ranking Jamaat official. Despite all these reservations, we visited him. He invited us to his office and treated us as a very loving father would treat his daughters and resolved our issues immediately by granting us permission. For this reason, our trust in the administration of the Jamaat has strengthened and our faith has also increased. The Amir of the district of Khushab, Munawwar Majoka Sahib writes that he was an excellent administrator, noble by nature, and greatly helped others. He was extremely watchful over even the minutest aspects of his duties. In regards to his qualities of looking after the poor and meticulously discharging his duties, he writes, I shall relate a very small incident which has left an everlasting impression on my mind regarding his great character. He says that it was around the early part of 2015 that I was sat in my office and two ladies who were very poor and belonged from the area of Khushab came to me and said that Mia Sahib, i.e. Nazri Allah Sahib, had sent them to him in order to seek recommendation and a signature from the Amir of Khushab. He says that I interviewed them, and after listening to the ladies, I decided that we would provide them with aid through our own local district administration instead of sending them to the headquarters. And so I sent both of them to our district secretary Amure Amma, i.e. general affairs, and they were both given help. The next day I was sitting in my office, and Mia Sahib directly called me to inquire about the matter and said, "Yesterday I sent two ladies who came from your district and were facing some financial difficulties to you, so that they could obtain your recommendation and signature. However, they have not come today to receive any aid or help, and so I am worried that perhaps you send them back. Therefore, give your recommendation and send them back to me so that they can immediately be provided with help." However, I informed him that since we provided them help from the district level, therefore I did not send them to you. Amir Sahib Khushab further writes, "This minor incident serves as a small tribute to his great personality in respect to his care for the poor and serving mankind and taking great care of even the most minor of issues. This sense of responsibility should develop in all our office bearers in respect to how to fulfill a task. It should not be the case that one simply orders for something to happen. Rather, when a request is submitted, the one submitting it will of course try to follow it up, but so should the office bearers, and they should continue to oversee it until it is implemented, or until the complaint has been resolved, or the task has been fulfilled. Rather than simply neglecting it. As I mentioned before, that if this habit is instilled within the office bearers, then many of our issues will be resolved." Hafiz Muzaffar Ahmed Sahib writes that I am witness to the fact that Hazrat Mia Sahib discharged his responsibilities in such a manner that manifested his great love and devotion for Khilafat, and right up to his last breath, he did not overlook even a single thing in respect to his obedience to Khalifatul Masih and his pledge of waqf, i.e. life devotion. And he spent his entire life fulfilling the rights of God and fellow man. He held a very high post in the Jamaat, but despite this, he was filled with great humility and possessed excellent morals and was a disciplined administrator. Hafiz Sahib further writes, "He was an excellent model in regards to observing prayer in congregation. When he was appointed as the president for Ansarullah, i.e. the auxiliary organization for the elders of the community, he repeatedly reminded us about praying in congregation and observing prayer. In fact, he would say that you people may think that he only repeats this one thing, but what can I do? I will not be doing true justice to my responsibility if I do not continue reminding you. And I have noticed that let alone failing to pray in congregation, some office bearers completely missed their prayer. Similarly, whether it was hot or cold, he would always leave for office at the appointed time. Muhammad Anwar Sahib, who is one of the staff members in the office of Nazarat-e-Uliya, writes, "It is impossible to forget his kindness, compassion and love. He would always come on time and was an example for us all. Despite his old age and illness, he would come to office on time and would remain occupied in his office duties. He would always give precedence to serving faith over his own self. Before his demise, the last time he attended office was on the 1st of January, and he was experiencing a lot of difficulty in breathing. And it was clearly visible that he was experiencing a lot of difficulty. However, he was trying his utmost to conceal it." He further writes that he told me, I am not feeling well today, therefore I will leave the office early to go home. But this certainly does not mean that I will not do the work. He then said to the member of staff, that quickly bring all the letters that need to be signed. The staff member states, in compliance with the instruction, I quickly presented the letters. After he had signed a few files from the Vasir department, I said that since he is not well, we can get these files signed later. However, he said, bring the rest of the files, as nothing will happen. Thereafter, he gave various important instructions and met certain Naziran, i.e. directors of Sadr Anjuman, and other heads, and thus he demonstrated through his own example of how one should serve faith and the true spirit of Waqf, i.e. dedication. Then, a missionary of the community, Malik Muhammad Afzal Sahib, states, sitting in the mosque with his head lowered and being completely immersed in the dars, i.e. the lecture of the Holy Quran after the Asr prayer during the blessed month of Ramadan, and if anyone presented their personal issues to him, he would happily and calmly listen to what they had to say and would give a solution to their problem, were such traits that every inhabitant of Rabwa would witness daily. He further states, on one occasion during my studies in Jamia, I was going through an extremely worrying period. The situation seemed beyond my control, and it was only prayer alone that could resolve the situation. He says that I went to visit Mirza Khursheed Ahmad Sahib in his office, and despite his immense responsibilities and engagements, he invited me into his office. And I explained the whole situation, and though my intention was only to request him for prayers, however, he heard all my concerns and then asked further questions regarding it. He further states that prior to coming to his office, I had not even thought that I would be taking up so much of his time, but he showed great affection and gave me a lot of time. Thereafter, when I left his office, I felt a sense of relief in my heart and left the office with a sense of new hope. Such is the comfort that is compulsory for every office bearer to afford to others. He further states, he was extremely kind-natured and compassionate, as if an angel. A friend of mine once told me that I was only a teenager and still learning to ride a motorbike, and I crashed into the fence outside the house of Mia Khursheed Ahmad Sahib. By chance, Mia Sahib himself was watering the plants near the fence outside the street. I was extremely nervous, as well as greatly embarrassed, because not only was I at fault, but I was also riding underage. Moreover, I fell in front of him, and had it been anyone else, they perhaps would have admonished me greatly, as I'd caused damage to the garden. However, he was so kind-natured and compassionate that he immediately came to me and helped me get to my feet. He then asked whether I had sustained any serious injury, and then told me in a very loving manner that I should value and take care of my life. Similarly, he had a lot of love and affection for missionaries and waqfeen, i.e. devotees of life. And despite having a wealth of knowledge, he always displayed humility and politely expressed that he had no knowledge of any matter. During his first official convocation ceremony of the Shahid class, i.e. final year class of Jamia Ahmadiyya Pakistan, in which I had appointed him as my representative, and in his speech to the Jamia students, he said that I have spent my entire life listening to the directives of missionaries and learned scholars. Therefore, how can I say anything in front of you? However, he then imparted some advice, and amongst other things, he said that this humble one will only stress on one point, which is not only important, but absolutely vital, and that is to act on the directives issued by Khalifatul Masih. You should listen to all of them, then having pondered over them, you should act upon them to the utmost ability in your capacity as office bearers and missionaries who are graduating from here. We all should make this guidance an intrinsic part of our lives and strive to act upon it. We should also pray to God Almighty to grant us the opportunity to act upon these directives. a missionary from Badumali, Masood Sahib writes. He says that I had the opportunity to meet Mia Sahib on several occasions, and each meeting was filled with an ocean of love and affection. He was a popular personality who would show immense love and compassion to everyone. He was an embodiment of excellent morals and humility. He would rise from his chair to greet everyone that entered his office and shake their hands, even if the guest was a small child. Whenever someone would come to meet him, he would leave aside all his important work and would listen intently to what the other person had to say. And it was because of this quality that everyone would go to him with their troubles, and every single person has written this about him. In his office, he would deal justly with every single person, despite the fact whether they were rich, poor, an office bearer, or an ordinary Ahmadi. When a person would raise their issue with him, he would take action immediately and treated everyone as though each person was important. Dr. Nuri Sahib writes, he would be mindful of everyone's sentiments and emotions, as well as looking after their needs and requirements. Dr. Sahib further says, I remember on one occasion a patient required an angioplasty for which he was given a 50% subsidy. Later, when the patient contacted him, i.e. Nazri Allah Sahib, he exempted the other half of the fee. Dr. Nuri Sahib says that he then informed me that Hazur has instructed me to help all those patients that are in need. Therefore, it is our responsibility to fulfill this instruction. Dr. Saif further states, when he was undergoing treatment in hospital, he would say to the nurses, those male or female nurses that are under training, to buy everyone sweaters as a gift from him and to ask his son to pay for it. He would appreciate the efforts of others. Dr. Nuri Saif further states, one day he wrote to me saying that on occasions one harbors certain emotions and sentiments that it is impossible to express to another verbally, i.e. expressing it in person. He further writes, I also had similar feelings and sentiments when I was leaving. In other words, leaving the hospital. May Allah the Almighty grant you immense blessings for this. He further states that he also had great love and affection for Khilafat. Dr. Nuri Sahib also wrote that he had a special connection with Tahir Heart Hospital. He writes, on one occasion he said to me, Nuri, Tahir Heart is like the brainchild of the Khalifa of the time. May Allah the Almighty fulfill the desires of the Khalifa and may this institute become the true Darul Shifa, i.e. the house of healing. He also told Nuri Sahib that he prays every day that may Allah the Almighty fulfill all the wishes of the Khalifa. Dr. Nuri Sahib then says that when I would write down a daily report of his health, Nuri Sahib would send me an update on a daily basis. And he continues that one day he held my hand and overcome with emotion he said, aside from illness and pain, do we not have any good news to present to Hazur? Likewise, there are many letters which mention incidents similar to these, and they all spoke of his quality of humbleness and compassion. He expressed his love and connection with Khilafat in an incident when my wife once asked him that as you pray for the Khalifa, please also remember me and my children in your prayers. To this he replied, in the specified sajda, i.e. prostration, where I pray for the Khalifa of the time, I also pray for his wife and children. And whilst he was mentioning this, he was overcome with great emotion. His obedience to the Amir and also his superiors was of a very high standard. In the year 2000, when Hazrat Khalifatul Masih IV was unwell, Myself and Mirza Khursheed Ahmad Sahib came to London. At the time, I was serving as Nazri Allah, and we had a slight difference of opinion over a certain matter, in which he sternly rejected one of my statements. Nonetheless, the matter came to a close, and I left London and returned to Rabwa a few days before him. A few days later, he came to my office and sat down with a solemn expression. He then said that I have come to apologize, as I have made a grave mistake. I said, "Which matter are you referring to, as I have no recollection of any?" He replied that the disagreement we had in London, I spoke in a manner which exhibited anger, and this is against the respect that should be shown to an Amir. Therefore, I seek forgiveness and apologize for the matter. And despite the fact that I said that there was no need to apologize, he repeatedly expressed regret. Thus, this was the level of his humility and the respect for the Amir. Then, in regards to reformation, he would begin at home. It was not the case that he would admonish other children and overlook his own children. A few years ago, I wrote a letter to the Khandan, i.e. family members of the Promised Messiah alayhi salatu wassalam, in which I reminded them of their duties and responsibilities. I advised them as a whole about certain complaints that I had received. When I sent this letter to Pakistan, I asked him to gather the members of the Khandan, i.e. members of the Promised Messiah alayhi salam's family, and read out my letter before them. And so, when he read out this letter before the members of the Promised Messiah alayhi salam's family, he was overcome with emotion, and he said that, "Let me make this evidently clear, that my own children are not free from these issues that have been highlighted, and that I advise them and their children to address these shortcomings and strive to meet the expectations of the Khalifa." This was the level of his truthfulness and righteousness. May Allah the Almighty enable his children to continue his virtuous deeds. And may Allah the Almighty bestow the Jamaat and also Khilafati Ahmadiyya helpers who are loyal, sincere, and those who adhere to the subtle points of righteousness. Mirza Anas Sahib, who is the eldest son of Hazrat Khalifatul Masih III, has written to me stating that my dear brother Khursheed served the community until his last breath under the shade of Khilafat. May Allah the Almighty elevate his status and accept his services. Also, may he bestow countless blessings on him and keep him in the shade of his mercy. He fulfilled his pledge, and this is absolutely correct, in that he most certainly fulfilled his pledge. May Allah the Almighty enable us all to fulfill the true spirit of our pledges and enable us to complete them. Inshallah, after the prayers, I will lead his funeral prayer in absentia.
Alhamdulillah, nahmaduhu wa nasta'inuhu wa nastaghfiruhu wa nu'minu bihi wa natawakkalu alayhi wa na'uzu billahi min shururi anfusina wa min sayyiati a'malina. من يهده الله فلا مضل له ومن يضلل فلا هادي له ونشهد أن لا إله إلا الله ونشهد أن محمدا عبده ورسوله عباد الله رحمكم الله إن الله يأمر بالعدل واللسان وإيتاء ذي القربى وينهى عن الفحشاء والمنكر والبغي يعظكم لعلكم تذكرون اذكروا الله يذكركم وادعوه يستجب لكم ولذكر الله أكبر.
اللهم صل على محمد وعلى آل محمد.